Okay, so apologetics, right off the bat. What is apologetics? Apologetics is the branch of theology which offers a defense for the truth of the Christian religion. So when we're talking about apologetics, what we're talking about is giving a reasoned defense for the faith, all right? And, of course, the Bible, as our ultimate authority, gives us, it talks quite a bit about apologetics. Okay, and the token verse for apologetics in the Scriptures comes from 1 Peter 3:15. So if you can see it up here, that's great. If not, you might want to turn there in your Scriptures because we're going to talk about this for a little bit. So it says, "But in your hearts honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you, yet do it with gentleness and respect." Okay, so here we're told that we need to be able to give a reason to everyone. Okay, to honor Christ the Lord as holy, be prepared all the time to give a defense to anyone who asks, and do it with gentleness and respect. So the first part of this text is absolutely essential, and that's why it comes first in the text, all right? Honor Christ the Lord as holy. Okay, and this is a part of this verse that sometimes we just glance over and we don't really understand how it applies to the rest of this text. So we're told to honor Christ the Lord as holy and be ready to answer anyone. So if Christ is Lord, then he is our ultimate authority. There is no higher authority than him because Christ is the truth. John 14:6, he says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." Then to honor him, we must do all things according to truth. And all truth is according to Jesus Christ. And so when we're honoring Christ the Lord as holy, we're sanctifying Christ as Lord. We're setting him apart as holy and as our Lord. The Lordship of Christ is holy, never to be set aside in our argumentation. Never to be set aside in our argumentation. Jesus Christ is Lord over us, is Lord over our argumentation, okay? And so set him aside as holy, as Lord. Jesus Christ is Lord. And Christ is not just Lord over me and Lord over my argument. He's Lord over all things. So Jesus Christ is Lord over me and my argument. He's also Lord over the unbeliever that I'm talking to. Whether that unbeliever recognizes it or not, Jesus Christ is Lord over him, whether he submits to it or not. He's Lord over all of creation. Okay, so all of reality he is Lord over. And he's Lord over every fact, everything that is true, everything that is according to a reality as he has created it. He is Lord over all things. And so our apologetic must reflect this by being consistent with the inspired word of God. So everything we do in our apologetic has to be consistent with Jesus Christ being Lord and therefore consistent with what he has revealed in his word. All right? Always be ready to answer anyone is the second part of this verse here. So there must be some way that the simplest believer can be equipped to answer anyone at any time. So this doesn't just say, find an apologetic situation, go home and study it, and then come back and answer it. No, it says we need to be able to offer an answer at any time to anyone who asks. Okay, so what do? Do we go out and do we study historical facts, and we study geology, and we study astronomy, and all these things? We need to be experts in every field of science and history that there is. Or is there something a little simpler? And I would say that there is something a little bit simpler that we can do to be ready to answer anyone with anything that they bring forward. All Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. So the Scriptures are inspired by God. They are breathed out by God. Holy men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit, and they are sufficient to equip us for apologetics. we can be complete and equipped for every good work. Is apologetics a good work? Yes, it is. It's a good work. We're commanded to do it. Okay, and so the scriptures are enough to equip us for every good work, including apologetics. So from the scriptures, we can refute error and hold up truth. From the scriptures, we just need to believe what the scriptures say and apply it to the situation, okay? And so also, the last part of 1 Peter 3:15, do it with gentleness and respect. Our attitudes ought always to adorn the gospel of Jesus Christ. We can do apologetics with gentleness and respect because we believe God and know that this is his work, okay? 2 Timothy 2:24 to 25 echoes this, and it tells us, we'll look a little closer at that verse, but basically what it tells us to do is answer gently, kindly, respectfully, that God may grant repentance, okay? So our role in that is to answer with gentleness and respect. God's role is to grant repentance and see to it that he is glorified. So if we're to be equipped to honor Christ the Lord as holy, we are to be equipped to honor Christ the Lord as holy, answer anyone who asks, and do it with gentleness and respect. So our apologetics need to be deeply rooted and consistent with the revelation that God has given us. All right? Okay, so our next, the next section here, we're going to look at the Bible. Okay, as Christians, we have a worldview, and the Bible ought to be the highest authority because it comes directly from God. And so the Bible forms our worldview. God has revealed the nature of reality, including that of God, man, creation, and their relationship to one another. Okay? And certain objective truths about reality are immediately pertinent to apologetic encounters that we find ourselves in. So we're going to go through a few things that the scriptures say that immediately should immediately affect how we do apologetics if we want to be consistent with the scriptures. Okay? So number one is God created everything there is. Kind of goes without saying, but it's very important. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Okay? And John 1 verse 3 says, all things were made through him, that is Jesus Christ, and without him was not anything made that was made. And Colossians 1:16 says, for by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. That is Jesus Christ. So Jesus Christ is Lord. He has created all things, and they're all created for him. All right? People are made in God's image. This is important to remember when we're doing apologetics. God said, let us make man in our image and after our likeness. We'll go a little bit later into what exactly this means and how it affects our apologetic. This is very important, and this is something that often we don't think about when we are doing apologetics, but this is a biblical truth. God is known because God has made himself known. Okay, God does not fail in making himself known. He has made himself known to everyone. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. So the creation makes God's existence obvious. Romans 1:19 and 20 says, for what can be known about God is plain to them, that is to everyone, because God has shown it to them. Could God fail if he intends to show what can be known about him? If he intends to show that to everyone, can he fail at that? No, he's going to accomplish that. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made, so they are without excuse. So God has made himself known. God has revealed himself to everyone. And that renders man without an excuse. Okay? And the Bible says, the fool has said in his heart there is no God. So it's the fool who rebels against this this knowledge that he has of God. So it's utterly foolish to say that there is no God. Man has sinned and is at war with his creator. So the Bible says that before Christ, when we were in Adam, we were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. Romans 5:10 says, "For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more now that we are reconciled shall we be saved by his life." So we are at enmity with God before we came to Christ. Before God saved us, we were literally the enemy of God, at war with him. Man actively suppresses the knowledge of God in their sinful state and cannot do otherwise. So God has made himself known, but man, because he is a sinner, actively suppresses what he knows about God, actively rebels against the knowledge that he has. Okay, so we're not talking about guys running around here just sinning because they don't know any better. They know that God exists. They know that there is that because he has made himself known, but they actively rebel against it. The wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. And 1 Corinthians 2:14 says, "The natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are folly to him, and he is not able to understand them because they are spiritually discerned. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh," Romans 8. "For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God," hostile towards God. "For it does not submit to God's law, indeed it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God." That verse goes on, that section goes on to define in the flesh as being those who are not saved, those who are not indwelt by the Holy Spirit. So, we, before Christ, we suppress the truth about God, okay? If you think about suppression, by the way, almost nothing I say in this is going to be original to me, okay? So I don't take credit for these analogies and things that I use. They're things I've heard other places, but they work really well. And so when you think about suppression, think about this. Think about, have you ever been in a swimming pool and sat on a beach ball and tried to suppress that beach ball under the water? Try to keep it under the water. You got to pay a lot of attention to suppressing that beach ball under the water because naturally it wants to float. Okay? And so this is exactly what the sinner is like before Christ too, okay? And this is something that we have to keep in mind during our apologetic encounters is even though we suppress the truth of God, it cannot entirely be eliminated. And so as soon as a person is not paying attention to suppressing it, quite often it'll pop up. We need to be able to spot that when it happens. We'll talk about that a lot more. So number six, because they suppress the truth, by rejecting Christ, they are leaving off the only true foundation for knowledge. Okay? And so I only quoted part of Colossians 2 there, but I think it's important. Talking about Christ, it says, "In whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge." And then Paul says, "I say this in order that no one may delude you with plausible arguments." Okay? So, in Christ is all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. He is the truth. Nothing can be known outside of him because he, in him are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. And Proverbs 1:7 says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction." So because they reject the only foundation that is true, they cannot make sense of the world. This leaves them in darkness and ignorance in which they construct vain, incoherent, inconsistent philosophies, religions, and worldviews. Okay, you ever wonder why there's so many religions in the world, why there's so many philosophies in the world, why no one can agree on anything? It's because they've left off the knowledge of God. They've suppressed it. They've ignored it. They've purposely left that foundation. "For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things." That's Romans 1, 21 through 23. Ephesians 4 says, "Now this I say and testify in the Lord, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do in the futility of their minds." Futile thinking, futility of their minds. "They are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to their hardness of heart." So the reason that they can't make sense of anything is because they're hard at heart. They hate God. And Colossians 2:8 says, "See to it that no one takes you captive by philosophy and empty deceit, according to human tradition, according to the elemental spirits of the world, and not according to Christ." Are you starting to get the picture of what's going on here? It is the Christian's job to expose the folly of rejecting God and challenge the unbeliever. So we destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against knowledge of God and take every thought captive to obey Christ. And 1 Corinthians 1:20 says, "Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world?" God has made foolish the wisdom of this world. Let's see here. All right. "The unbeliever is converted and his mind is enlightened, not by your argument with him, but by the Spirit of God, by the means of scriptural truth being proclaimed." So faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ, is what it says in Romans 10:17. "For since the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe." And in 1 Corinthians 2:1-5, Paul says, "And I, when I came to you, brothers, did not come proclaiming to you the testimony of God with lofty speech or wisdom, for I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and much trembling, and my speech and my message were not in plausible words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and power, and of power, so that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the wisdom of God." And then finally, "Salvation and sanctification restore men to God and cause them to see with greater clarity as they submit to his word." So seeing that you have put off the old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge after the image of its creator. And then John 7:17 says, if anyone's will is to do God's will, which, by the way, the lost man, his will is never to do God's will. But if anyone's will is to do God's will, he will know whether this teaching is from God or whether I am speaking of my own authority. That's what Jesus said. So, now I got to find my spot in my notes here. But these truths, the truths we just talked about here, are important to consider in every evangelistic and apologetic encounter that we have. Men are not neutral to God. Not the true and living God anyways. Maybe to their idols. But in their sin, they actively hate God. They run from him and are willing to embrace any variety of worldview as long as it is not the truth with Jesus Christ as their Lord at its foundation. While this sinful hatred of God and suppression of truth may manifest itself in different ways, in different people, the foundational truth is the same universally. So this affects everyone. And by the way, it affected you and I before we came to Christ as well. And we must always keep that in mind. So, what method? All right. So not many people give a lot of thought to apologetic methodology necessarily. But the truth is, it is possible to do apologetics wrong. And by that, we don't mean with the wrong attitude or in a mean way or something like that. But what we mean is we can do it in a way that's inconsistent with Scripture. And we need to make sure if Jesus Christ is our Lord, if we're honoring him as Lord in our hearts, that everything we do is according to the Scriptures, including our apologetics. So apologetic methodology should flow directly from your theology. That said, it must be sure that our apologetic methodology is consistent with biblical revelation about God, man, and the world. So, there are three distinct methodologies when it comes to Christian apologetics. So the first here is the classical apologetic methodology. How many of you guys knew that there's more than one way to do apologetics? Okay, so a few of us, all right. So we got three here. The first one's a classical apologetic methodology. So this tends to appeal to the unbeliever's reason and evidences to demonstrate the existence of God and or the truth of the Bible. All right, so common arguments that you might recognize from a classical methodology would be things like the cosmological argument, okay, or the teleological argument. So the cosmological argument says everything that had a beginning must have had something that caused it. Therefore, the universe had a beginning, therefore there must have been a cause before that, and that cause is God. And since God is not caused, he doesn't need a cause. All right? That's very simply stated, but that's... So you might recognize arguments like that. Teleological argument argues from design and that everything is wonderfully works together and seems designed, and therefore there must be a God. So usually it's a two-step method, often proving first the existence of God and then trying from there to prove that God is the God of the Bible. So this is a two-step argument, usually. The evidential apologetic methodology is very similar to the classical. It appeals to evidences for the truth of the Christian faith, so it often will stress data as evidence for the existence of God and biblical events, i.e., historical arguments for the resurrection or miracles or Old Testament events or the existence of certain people and places and things and that kind of thing to demonstrate the likelihood that the claims of the Bible and Christianity are true. Okay. And then the third goes by a number of different names because everybody seems to like to give it what they think is a more accurate name. The presuppositional or covenantal or reformed apologetic methodology, and I'm going to talk about it in this as the reformed apologetic methodology because it's easier. All right, and so this methodology appeals to the scriptures as the ultimate authority. It's our starting point, and it's our axiom, okay? It's the thing that we start with, and all of our reasoning comes out of that, all right? By the way, this is the one that I'm going to be teaching today, and I'll explain why we hold to this one as being the correct way. So it applies the Bible's claims about God, man, the universe, and their relationship to the unbeliever and his arguments in the conversation, in the apologetic encounter, constantly taking scriptural truth and applying it. Seeks to demonstrate that because Christianity is true, it alone can consistently, coherently account for the universe and human experience, and that any other worldview results logically, consistently applied, results in absolute absurdity and destroys reasoning, destroys understanding in the universe. And so the position then is that because Christianity is true, it's the only one that can consistently be applied to reality and make any sense of anything. Okay? So, as Christians, we desire, obviously, to exercise an apologetic methodology which is consistent with the scriptures and reject those ideas which find their source somewhere else. When examining the classical and evidential approaches, we find inconsistencies with scripture at the very outset, and so we reject classical apologetic methodology and evidential apologetic methodology. We reject those because we say the starting point is unbiblical. So how is that? Well, they assume an intellectually neutral starting point. They assume that you and the unbeliever are basically starting on the same ground, all right? What it fails to account for is the fact that there is no neutrality in anyone's thinking. The unbeliever is not neutral, and we should not be either. We should be holding to the scriptures, and he is constantly, in his mind, going to be at war with his creator and at war with the truth. And so we have to recognize that distinction, and these two methodologies do not recognize that. As soon as we assume the unbeliever's neutrality and attempt to argue from a neutral position with him, we've abandoned the lordship of Jesus Christ. As soon as we say, okay, the Bible's not my ultimate authority anymore, then Jesus Christ is not your Lord anymore. It's serious. And we're dragged into arguing not ultimately on a neutral ground, because the unbeliever will never be neutral, but we're ultimately dragged into arguing on his terms based on his worldview. That's what will end up happening. So the classical and evidential approaches present Christianity as a highly probable option. So arguments and evidences which make the truth of Christianity highly probable but not absolutely true put God's word into question when he has said that he has revealed himself to everyone and that everyone already has all the evidence that they need. So in an evidential approach, you're presenting evidence to someone who the Bible says has enough evidence and suppresses it already. What's he going to do with more evidence? He's going to suppress it. So with that said, the real goal of apologetics, here's that 2 Timothy scripture that I talked about earlier. The Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but kind to everyone, able to teach, patiently enduring evil, correcting his opponents with gentleness. God may perhaps grant them repentance, leading to a knowledge of the truth. So what comes first, a knowledge of the truth or repentance? You can answer out loud. What comes truth, a knowledge? What comes first, a knowledge of the truth or repentance? It says God may perhaps grant them repentance, leading to a knowledge of the truth. And what does that assume? That assumes that without repenting first, they'll never come to an understanding of the truth. Okay, so the problem isn't that they don't have the enough truth. The problem is that they suppress it sinfully and they need to repent, that they may come to their senses and escape from the snare of the devil after being captured by him to do his will. And so, at the very outset of our discussion of apologetics, we understand what the goal of apologetics is. We understand that we will never argue a person into saving faith. That is a gift of God, and it's given as he pleases. The goal of apologetics is to stop the mouth of the unbeliever and proclaim truth. It's the proclamation of the gospel which has the power to save. When we proclaim truth, God is glorified, and the lordship of Jesus Christ is exalted. It's God's good pleasure to use the proclamation of truth as he sees fit. This is one of my favorite scriptures ever. But thanks be to God who in Christ always leads us in triumphal procession. So we're always triumphing in Christ, okay? And through us, he spreads the fragrance of the knowledge of him everywhere. For we are the aroma of Christ to God among those who are being saved and among those who are perishing. To one, a fragrance from death to death. To the other, a fragrance from life to life. Who is sufficient for these things? For we are not, like so many, peddlers of God's word, but as men of sincerity, as commissioned by God, in the sight of God, we speak Christ. And that's the heart of the evangelist and the apologist. Okay? So, in conclusion, God is and he has spoken. This is the foundation of everything. This is the foundation of all that everything we're going to do in apologetics, everything we're going to do in evangelism, everything we're going to do in our Christian life. The foundation of all of it is that God is and he has spoken. All right? So our apologetic methodology must start with the starting point that the one God of Christianity has made himself known to every person, but that men in their sin suppress the truth about him. So he's made himself known. And the person that you're talking to knows God, then, if you believe what the Bible says. The person might with their mouth say that they don't know God, but we're going to talk a little bit later about how you can expose to them that with their life and the way that they live, they do in fact know God. So the one God of Christianity has made himself known to every person. Men in their sin suppress the truth about him and are in active rebellion against him. The Reformed apologetic methodology presents the Christian worldview as being true by arguing the impossibility of the contrary and demonstrating that all other worldviews created by men are deficient and ultimately incoherent and inconsistent, rendering them impossible. The Reformed method seeks to imply simply to proclaim this truth and the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ to the lost sinner with faith that God's word is sufficient to reveal the unbeliever's need for Christ. In doing this, we pray that God will grant them repentance, leading to a knowledge of the truth. Okay, this is a great quote that I found that someone pointed out to me from the 5th century, okay, so that's the 400s, from a guy named Salvian the Presbyter, and he sounds like a presuppositionalist to me. He sounds like a Reformed apologist, all right? He says, "I need not prove by arguments what God himself proves by his own words. When we read that God says he perpetually sees the entire earth, we prove thereby that he does see it because he himself says he sees it. When we read that he rules all things he has created, we prove thereby that he rules, since he testifies that he rules. When we read that he ordains all things by his immediate judgment, it becomes evident by this very fact, since he confirms that he passes judgment. All other statements said by men require proofs and witnesses. God's word is his own witness, because whatever uncorrupted truth says must be the undefiled testimony of truth." And I love that, because a lot of people claim that methodology of apologetics is something that's new and just introduced even in the 20th century. But we see here that in the 400s, in the 5th century, this was the view of at least some people, right? So it's our conviction that the Reformed methodology is the biblical apologetic methodology. And this is the reason why. It assumes the Bible is true. Therefore, it assumes a biblical anthropology, so what man is like, who man is, what he is like, as well as a biblical soteriology, so that is how man is saved. So the Reformed methodology takes all of the Bible's truth and applies it to the argumentation, to the entire encounter, all right, to even how the apologist, especially to how the apologist thinks about the encounter. And we derive our argumentation directly from the text of the Bible. So in these ways, the Reformed apologetic relies entirely on Scripture. And that is how you set Jesus Christ aside as holy, as Lord, in our apologetics, just like 1 Peter 3:15 said. The truth of Christianity, and this is important, the truth of Christianity is not just one viable, reasonable option among many. The Christian God is not one whose existence relies on the intellectual assent of his creation. God's creatures depend on him, both believing and non-believing, to sustain them and the rest of reality, including their arguments against him. And we'll see later how no argument against God, no argument that an unbeliever can bring up against the God who's created them and all things, no argument that they can possibly mount against God has any validity unless biblical Christianity is true. So Christianity is certainly true to the exclusion of every competing worldview.